somebody to know, somebody to have, somebody to hold. It's easy to say, but it's never the same. I guess I kinda like the way you numbed all the pain. Now the day bleeds into nightfall, and you're not here to get me through it all. I let my guard down, and then you pulled the rug. I was getting kinda used to being someone you loved. I'm going under, and this time I fear there's no one to turn to. This all or nothing way of loving, go be sleeping without you. Now I need somebody to know, somebody to hear, somebody to have, just to know how it feels. It's easy to say, but it's never the same. I guess I kinda like the way you help me escape. Now the day bleeds into nightfall, and you're not here to get me through it all. I let my guard down, and then you pulled the rug. I was getting kinda used to being someone you loved. And I tend to close my eyes when it hurts. Sometimes I fall into your arms. I'll be safe in your soul till I come back around. For now the day bleeds into nightfall, and you're not here to get me through it all. I let my guard down, and then you pulled the rug. I was getting kinda used to being someone you love, but now the day bleeds into nightfall, and you're not here to get me through it all. I let my guard down, and then you pulled the rug. I was getting kinda used to being someone you love. I let my guard down, and then you pulled the rug. I was getting kinda used to being someone you love. Time I fear there's no one to save me. This all or nothing really got away, you're driving me crazy. I need somebody to hear, somebody to know, somebody to have, somebody to hold. It's easy to say, but it's never the same. I guess I kinda like the way you numbed all the pain. Now the day bleeds into nightfall, and you're not here to get me through it all. I let my guard down, and then.
Hola, buenas tardes. Buenas tardes a todos. Bienvenidos a nuestra segunda charla de nuestra semana en Peruviano. La verdad es que en este momento tenemos, tanto el doctor Lumi, hablo por él también aquí presente, pero los dos, sumamente emocionados de tener al doctor Knowles en este momento con nosotros. Desde cuando me confirmó su aceptación a participar, que estaba muy, muy contento de poder tener una figura tan importante como él con nosotros. La verdad es que esta semana nos dimos todos los lujos de poder tener a todos los referentes mundiales en patología de piso pelviano, de Europa, de Estados Unidos. Así que la verdad es que esta semana fue inolvidable, me parece, ¿no, doctor Lumi? Así que, para mí, no sé si le gusta mucho el fútbol al doctor Knowles, pero para mí es como estar ahora haciendo una entrevista a Messi, o no sé, bueno, o quizás otro jugador, depende de su preferencia. Pero bueno, muy contento de poder estar con él acá. Voy a presentar al doctor Charles Knoll, que nos va a dar su charla sobre algoritmos de programación en neuromodulación sacra y recomendaciones para la práctica diaria basadas en la evidencia. El doctor Charles Knoll es cirujano colorectal, es especialista en coloproctología, director adjunto del Instituto Blizzard, profesor honorario de terapéutica experimental en la Universidad de Londres, licenciado en estudios en la Universidad de Cambridge, doctorado en la Universidad de Londres, fellow del Royal College of Surgeons, director del Centro Nacional de Investigación Intestinal de Inglaterra, presidente de comités de investigación de la European Society of Coloproctology, la Asociación de Coloproctología de Gran Bretaña e Irlanda y de la Sociedad Internacional de Incontinencia, miembro del Comité de Roma 4 para Trastornos Funcionales Anorrectales, proctor y miembro del panel de expertos de Medtronic, autor de vastísimas publicaciones revisadas y varios capítulos del libro. La verdad es que soy un fiel lector de todo lo que el Dr. Knoll publica y su grupo de trabajo. Consultor honorario del Barth Health National Health System. Así que, Dr. Knoll, sinceramente, ¿cómo?
Y músico.
Y músico. Y músico y cantante, exactamente. Que no es mucho, no, me faltó otra cosa, una beta muy importante también. Así que, antes de darle la palabra al Dr. Knoll para comenzar su presentación, quiero avisarle a toda la gente que sepan que tienen abajo a su derecha de la pantalla un globito que dice español o inglés o translation. Ahí pueden elegir para escuchar la traducción en línea o escuchar directamente al Dr. Knoll en inglés. Y tienen la opción de preguntas y respuestas para escribir cualquier tipo de consulta o comentario que quieran hacer al doctor. Así que no sé si doctor Lumi quiere decir algo al respecto. Doctor Knoll, un placer enorme, sinceramente, y más estando de vacaciones. Muchísimas, muchísimas gracias por estar con nosotros.
Okay. It's a great pleasure and an honor to give this talk tonight. And thank you for inviting me. Would you like me to start the talk? Yep.
Perfecto. Okay.
So, okay, well, thanks once again for inviting me. I have been to Buenos Aires in the past. I came with the Philharmonia Orchestra to Buenos Aires and Rosario in the 90s sometime. So I have seen Buenos Aires, but I've been to Brazil rather more than I've been to Argentina. And I'm a Leeds United supporter who've just been promoted to the Premiership. So that's good. So I'm going to talk about practical programming for neuromodulation. Greetings, of course, from the East End of London. These are three photos I took only last week when I was cycling with my son. And for those of you who don't know, the Royal London Hospital, where I mainly work, is just round the corner from the Tower of London and from Tower Bridge that you can see in the photos, and from the City of London, which is our main commercial district. So if you ever come to our hospital, you will be able to walk very easily to see these other sites in London. I have a number of disclosures, which are...
You have to share your screen.
Oh, right. I thought I...
We are seeing you, but not your screen. Okay.
Can you see the screen now?
That's great.
Okay, I'll go back. Okay, I'll go back up. Hang on.
Yeah, go back to see the photo.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I'll start again. So thanks once again for inviting me. This is the title of my presentation, which has already been presented. And these are the pictures I was talking about when I said that if you come to our hospital in London, it is just round the corner from the Tower of London, Tower Bridge, and the City of London, as shown in the pictures here. And the weather is particularly hot here at the current time. So good time to come over and see us. I have a number of disclosures that are relevant to this talk. The ones on the left column all relate to neuromodulation and are mainly research collaborations. Although, as mentioned, I am an expert consultant for Medtronic, and you should bear that in mind when I'm giving my talk. So in terms of my talk today, I will give an introduction. Then I'm going to talk about electrode configuration, then pulse amplitude and duration, and then cycling and pulse frequency, and finally make some general recommendations. So by way of introduction, coming back to the basics, neuromodulation involves the use of electricity for therapeutic benefit, and most implantable pulse generators produce a DC current, as shown in the schematic here, and that causes a charge separation around the nerve. So the nerve can be thought of as a resistor, but it can also be thought of as a capacitor. So a nerve is something that separates charge, and it is that charge separation which is key to the medical benefit of neuromodulation as concerns axonal depolarization. And one of the things that facilitates that is the myelination of nerves, because between the nodes of Ranvier, between the myelin, allows for greater charge separation. And it's this phenomenon that means, in part, why myelinated nerves are depolarized more easily than smaller unmyelinated nerves. But the key point is that charge separation is what we're looking for with neuromodulation. This slide is a little bit more complicated, and it doesn't matter whether you understand everything on it. Over to the left is charge as a function of distance from a source in terms of electric field strength. And this obeys Coulomb's law, the equation of which is shown below the graph. The key point is that the R4 function in the equation below the thing, that is that as you move further away, it is to the function of 4 rather than the distance affects your field strength and to the square. And that means that it is very key that the electrode is placed adjacent or as adjacent as possible to the nerve. What the other diagram shows here is the activation function, and it shows the separation of charges in two nerves, one of which is larger than the other. And as you can see, the larger myelinated nerve has greater separation of the nodes of Ranvier. What this means in effect is two things. Firstly, that the charge separation leads to an easier activation of large myelinated nerves than small. It also means that the closer you are to the nerve, the better. And finally, it is an explanation, which I'm not going to give here because it's complicated, of why cathodic stimulation is better than anodic stimulation. So we can, for the purposes of this talk, consider that the cathode is the active electrode as concerns depolarization of a nerve. This diagram produced by Medtronic shows the good positioning or excellent positioning of the multipolar electrode along the S3 route. And the key point here is to reinforce the fact that we want to surf the nerve with the electrode so that all electrode contacts are lying adjacent to the nerve and in close proximity for the reasons I've explained with Coulomb's law. And with this in mind, and I think you've already heard from Klaus Matzel during your meeting about the standardization of electrode lead placement, but the key point is that you should read this paper if you haven't read it already. It is free open access. This is a step-by-step guide of how you can best place that electrode lead so that the majority of your electrodes are adjacent and close to the nerve. And I'm not going to talk further about that now because, as noted, it's been covered, I'm sure, very well by Klaus and the group of people who led to this, as shown in the photograph there, including myself and Klaus. And so what we're really talking about is placing a cathode next to the map, just really to explain why we look for certain intraoperative findings when we place that to determine whether our electrode is close to the nerve. And as you can see, that this field here overlaps the S3 nerve, that explains why you get vulval sensation, perineal and anal motor response, because the S3 nerve contributes to the pudendal response of the pelvic floor, from branch innervation to the levator ani muscle, which comes from the S3 and S4 root. And it also explains, because of the S3 contribution to the sciatic nerve, why you can look for the flexion of the big toe as an intraoperative response. So we look for all three of these things to determine whether we have a well-placed cathode in relation to the S3 nerve root. Now, the a pulse generator, like the one like InterStim or any of the other commonly used pulse generators in medicine, produces a square wave like the waveform shown here. And I'm going to come back to exactly what this waveform looks like in real life. This is a schematic. But what I want you to take from this is that there are various variables that can be altered with a square wave such as that shown. And those are the pulse amplitude, which can be measured in volts, but of course is related to the current at a fixed resistance, the pulse duration, usually measured in microseconds, and the pulse frequency, measured in hertz. In fact, when you look at the InterStim at the default parameters, what it is worth noting is that, of course, 210 microseconds is a very small proportion of the time between pulses. Because at 14 hertz, the time between pulses is about 71,500 microseconds, and the pulse duration is only 210 microseconds. So there is a much longer rectification phase than there is a stimulation phase. And a further point on this diagram I wish to make is that the rectification phase with all modern neurostimulators is one that balances the charges. So you can see that the line here dips slightly below the zero during the rectification phase. And this means that with chronic stimulation, there is no charge imbalance, which is important for the safety of the device in terms of nerve damage. So if we take the InterStim implantable pulse generator, we can have a number of configurations of electrodes, which I will come back to. It can provide an amplitude of pulse between 0 and 10 volts, a frequency of pulse between 2.1 and 130 hertz, a pulse duration between 60 and 450 microseconds, and it can cycle, in addition to this, between 0.1 seconds or right up to continuous stimulation for 24 hours. And the point I wish to make with this slide is that this means you have a huge number of choices that can be made in terms of programming a modern device like the InterStim 2. The problem is that at the moment with the current technology, that requires in general a patient to feel their stimulation effect, give feedback on its benefit, which we then take and reset the parameters, often in clinic, back to the device. And so this is a lengthy process. So if you've got these hundreds of different possibilities, clearly it is not possible to keep making hundreds of alterations that require the patient to come back. And this means, and really leads on to the content of my talk, which is that we need some rationale to decide what electrode configuration, which pulse duration and amplitude, what frequency and other parameters should be used rather than a trial and error approach. And of course, the importance of doing that is to optimize the clinical benefit, to reduce side effects, to minimize the energy consumption and therefore preserve the battery, and to ultimately reduce consultations and the costs associated with the therapy. And to this end, the same expert group that I presented earlier in respect to standardized lead placement met to try and produce a further paper, which was published this year, again in the journal Neuromodulation, on programming algorithms for sacral neuromodulation, clinical practice and evidence recommendations for day-to-day practice. And it is the content of this paper largely that I am going to present for the rest of this talk. It's worth saying about this expert group that it included 13 surgeons, including myself. Together we had an accumulated experience of 250 years of placement, particularly long-term placement for urological indications. It involved four meetings and some live surgeries that we studied, particularly in respect of the standardized lead placement. And here's a picture of the group, which I showed to you earlier, with many faces that I hope you will recognize. So the paper that I just showed you included a systematic review of the available literature as concerned the four main programming parameters that I'm going to talk about. And that included studies only on humans with chronic stimulation, and excluded modeling and a variety of other indications, and also the use in patients under 18 years of age. And to the right-hand side of the slide, you see the PRISMA diagram, a standard PRISMA diagram for a systematic review. And you can see that eventually, and unfortunately, there are only 12 studies that provided any useful information for the paper. And I'm going to supplement these as I go through with some of the animal data, really to show you how we've come to be where we are, as well as what to do. So we'll start now with electrode configuration. As all of you, I'm sure, in the audience know, the InterStim 2 device has four electrodes with the 3889 lead, which most people use now. Those electrodes are of equal size and equal spacing. And you can see a placed electrode to the right here using the standardized lead placement. Because we have multiple electrodes, it is possible to stimulate with either a bipolar or a unipolar setting. I'm sure everyone understands what that means, but for a bipolar setting, clearly you choose an anode and cathode from one of the four electrodes, whereas for unipolar setting, you choose one electrode to be the cathode, and the implantable pulse generator itself in the buttock acts as a distant anode. And it is thought, although these are theoretical diagrams, that the field effects for bipolar and unipolar vary, with a more focused effect at a point with unipolar than with bipolar settings. So here we have a 3889 lead and the case. And because of the number of electrodes and the fact that we can stimulate in unipolar and bipolar configurations, what can be seen is that there are a large number of different configurations that are possible. In fact, there are 59 combinations possible with an InterStim 2 device. And clearly this is far too large a number to try all of these electrodes on a trial and error approach. And indeed, we know that that doesn't work. So what is recommended is and what is possible, at least with initial programming, when one sends a patient away, is for them to have 8 combinations of programming, 4 in unipolar and 4 in bipolar. And these are the recommendations. Obviously, the unipolar is obvious. You can choose either electrode 0, 1, 2, and 3. Whereas for the bipolar electrodes, we recommend a larger separation of the electrodes, e.g. between 0 and 3, 3 and 1, 0 and 2, and 3 and 0. Now, you will notice here, and I can justify this slightly by an animal study, is that electrode 3 is favoured in general because of the electrode 3 is less subject to variability of placement than the more distal electrodes when you place your multipolar lead. So electrode 3 is in the inner cortex of the sacrum and in is a well-fixed position, usually in relation to the nerve, provided you've placed the electrode reasonably. But as everyone knows, as the electrode lead is advanced further in, it can follow the nerve or it can seldinger the nerve capsule, and sometimes that can result in it deviating away from the nerve. And for this reason, studies have shown that, and it's shown in the picture here, the two deviations of the electrode. So here, electrode 3 remains in the same place, but you can see by the time you reach electrodes 1 and 0, there is a very significant deviation between two placements of the lead. Now, hopefully, with a standardized approach, as I showed earlier, this won't happen too much, but it does happen. And for this reason, this animal study and a reasonable approach in humans is to select electrode 3, which can be shown on the diagram in the upper graph, as electrode 3 as the cathode and with electrode 0 as the anode in this study resulted in the lowest amplitude of stimulation. So it's worth noting that if you're using bipolar or unipolar stimulation, you may wish, as a starting point, to focus on electrode 3 as the cathode. Another important fact at this point is to decide how you determine what the optimal electrode is. And this diagram, which came from Stefan de Wachter's group in Antwerp in Belgium, offers some rigor to this approach. He uses these diagrams to map on the diagram where the sensation of stimulation is felt. And ideally, you want a central, so a midline stimulation. Opinions vary as to whether that wants to be in the perineum, the vulva, or the vagina. But one thing that is certain is that it does not want to be in the buttock or to the left of the right, left or the right, and particularly not in the thigh. So when choosing an electrode, we're looking for the lowest amplitude of stimulation with a midline stimulation effect in terms of the patient's reported sensation. And these diagrams can be used in the notes to denote that. So we can, there are a number of uncertainties left with electrode configuration, but some of the things that are now refuted in that were previously believed include the fact that bipolar is better than monopolar stimulation. This isn't true, at least with respect to the battery duration. An extended cathode does not help, e.g. the old 3093 lead, and nor do multiple cathodes and anodes. Put very simply, the extended cathode and the multiple cathodes make little sense when one considers that you're looking for charge separation and a charge density at a point along the nerve that you're stimulating. So the next thing I wish to talk about is pulse amplitude and duration. So One of the, back to a little bit of physics, but very simple physics, this equation is a vast simplification of the equation. But what it shows you is that the energy you provide to a nerve is proportional to the current you provide and the time, the duration of the pulse. And that makes pretty much obvious sense, I'm sure, to all of the audience. Actually, the formula that denotes this is the Lepeque-Hill formula, which you don't need to worry about. But if you apply that formula and plot a graph, you come up with this standard graph on the on activation functions, which describe the Rho base, of which is the lowest voltage at which you get a response from a nerve, and what's regarded as the chronaxy. It's not essential that you know all of this, but it's a bit of background. And in fundamentals of neuromodulation, it is generally regarded that optimal stimulation occurs at the chronaxy, which is defined as the duration of the pulse at which you have two times the Rho base. And you can see that on the graph here. And you can see also on the graph here that that for a standard peripheral nerve in humans falls at about 180, that should be 180 microseconds. Sorry, this is wrong on the graph. These should be in microseconds. And that of course is pretty close to the 210 microseconds we use in day-to-day practice. I said I would present some of the preclinical data in brief, but it's worth noting that the figure of 210 microseconds has not been completely pulled from the air at random. It is based on the considerable work of Walter Tanago and others in dogs, which led to the origin of this therapy, where they used 200 microseconds. There is evidence of sheep of the effectiveness of 210 microseconds, in pigs, 60 to 624 microseconds, and in rodents, 30 to 210 microseconds. So this reinforces the view that the default parameter of 210 microseconds is a reasonable choice. And when we surveyed our expert group as part of the study, which I presented, we found that in fact the mean amplitude in volts was 0.95, so that's pretty close to the two times the Rho base, and that the pulse duration was 215 microseconds. So not many people diverge from the 210 microsecond pulse duration. And that was based on 90 patients in the year 2017 on our practice. And these show actually some of the previous published data before the optimized lead placement came in. And what you can see here, the take-home message, is that much higher voltages in general were being used by many expert groups, many expert centers, including our own centers, prior to optimized lead placement, which suggests that the key point, which I reinforce now, that optimizing the lead placement so that your electrodes are adjacent to the nerve is absolutely key for this therapy. And that compares, as I've said, with about 1 volt from our own work and from this later study, published study using the optimized lead approach. So frequency and cycling are the next subject. Here shows, I put this slide on to show you that in the field of neuromodulation, a great range of frequencies are used for different indications, falling between low frequency stimulation at about 1 or 2 hertz, up to high frequency stimulation in the thousands of hertz. And the key points about this are first to note that R, this is a natural logarithmic scale, I should note on this graph, with an extension, the 14 hertz lies not only within the range possible with InterStim, but also well away from the low frequencies that are associated with perceptible muscle contraction, and well away from the high frequencies of stimulation that are known to be associated with nerve damage. I mean, one of the things about high frequency stimulation is that it's used to block nerves rather than to stimulate them, to depolarize them. So it would have no place in this therapy anyway, and it's used in other indications such as pain for spinal cord stimulation. Again, we have some preclinical data that support the 14 hertz default position, with Tanago studies in dogs use 10 hertz. In cats, 5 to 10 hertz seem effective, 15 to 50 hertz in pigs, and 2 to 14 hertz in rodents. So 14 hertz lies there or thereabouts with the animal literature as it stands. Now, in terms of humans, there are very few studies that have looked at variations in pulse width and frequency. And this is the best of those studies. There are two or three, and I'm only going to present this one. But it has to be noted that this study itself is flawed by the very small number of participants, and also slightly flawed by design. But nevertheless, this was a randomized study that randomized patients who already had a working implant to change their settings and express a preference based on a 5 different programs that were set in random order. And you can see that these varied in frequency and in pulse width. And the take-home message, if there is a take-home message from this study, is that the majority of patients' preferred setting, where it varied from the default setting, was for a frequency of 31 hertz. But it must be noted that this study is grossly underpowered to detect this difference, and there are problems with multiple comparisons, etc., which make the validity of this limited. So the this is a slide, or a single slide, on cycling. Not many people use cycling. As I've said, it is possible with the device to cycle between seconds of intermittent stimulation through to 24 hours. And obviously the energy given to the nerve is proportional to the amount of time that the stimulator is switched on. The advantage of cycling is that it will extend the battery life, although it must be noted that if you use very rapid cycling, that does not actually help the battery life because of the start-stop function uses energy. There is, however, a soft start-stop function to stop the patient feeling the stimulation going on and off. Data on this are extremely limited, and it may be that as we move forward with this, the use of cycling will be dependent on specific indications and other factors that we don't clearly understand yet. In terms of the expert group, you can see here that nearly everyone uses a pulse frequency of 14 hertz, with only a few varying from that, and very few people, 6 out of the 90, used cycling mode on their patients. So that takes me to the final recommendations. And these are in the paper for you to read. As I've noted, this paper is global open access, so you don't need to pay to obtain a copy of this paper. And these figures are within the paper. So this is this first figure relates to during the test phase using the multipolar lead. So I'm not options of electrode configuration on the unipolar lead during the test phase. You can use bipolar settings. You don't have an IPG, so you don't have the option of unipolar settings, but you can use bipolar settings. And you should try each of the four electrode configurations that I've previously shown on the previous slide, and then document the location of sensation and the sensory threshold to decide which of those four electrode settings is best, and send the patient away with that. If adverse stimulation occurs, you can move away from the wider settings to one where the anode is closer to the cathode. And as noted, you should always choose an electrode that has anal, perineal, or vulval sensation in the midline. And so that's the main recommendation for the test phase of sacral neuromodulation. When it comes to the post-implantation and the initial programming, and I'm only going to talk about the initial programming here, rather than troubleshooting, which is a quite separate lecture, it is now the recommendation of the expert group that you try monopolar settings in the first instance, using the four available electrodes. So use the standard settings of 14 Hertz, 210 microseconds, try each of the four electrodes as the cathode against the IPG, and again, use the location of sensation and sensory threshold to determine which of those cathodes is preferable to produce the best sensation, and send the patient away with that as the initial program. So in addition to that, of course, having given them this program, you can give four further programs, or three further programs, individually for the patient, and seven predefined programs are possible. But one program is, of course, a much simpler way of doing this. But counter to that is the possibility that having more than one program, of course, reduces the need for the patient to actually come back and see you face to face for any changes. What is important is that the patient makes no changes too rapidly, and that they should try any program change for at least 4 weeks before reaching any valid conclusion. The other facts in the initial programming is that it is generally considered that the program should be given at least 48 hours after surgery to allow the effects of anesthesia and any other effects to wear off from the patient's hospital visit. The first reprogramming should be scheduled for between 6 weeks and 3 months, and that thereafter you should have a further 6 month reprogramming, and then twice per year for following years. Although it's noted that if people are on particularly stable settings, the frequency of that reprogramming can be reduced. So in summary, ladies and gentlemen, of what I've said today, the first point to make is that no amount of programming will compensate for the bad placement of an electrode lead. So this comes back to the talk given by Klaus Matzel to some of my earlier slides. It is absolutely essential that everyone learns the optimized lead placement to give patients the best opportunity of benefit from this, from the InterStim device. The second point to make is that actually only a very small number of logical programs are required at initial programming. And for many patients, this can be one well-chosen program, as I've indicated on the previous slides. And what we really want to avoid is the trial and error approach of lots of different programs being tried, both in terms of electrode configurations, pulse durations, frequencies, etc., with no clear rationale. It is generally considered that the default settings, that's the duration of pulse, the frequency, without cycling, are backed up by the preclinical literature and practical and evidence from practice of experts, and should be used unless there is a very clear rationale for doing anything else. And finally, the frequent reprogramming probably represents the poor placement of an electrode. So if a patient keeps coming back requiring reprogramming, one should think about troubleshooting that electrode in terms of getting an X-ray, retesting the impedances, and considering whether that patient needs a revision of their electrode lead. Thank you very much.
Muy bien, la verdad, interesantísima la charla, doctor Knowles. Una precisión increíble, con toda la precisión que estuvo hablando de todos los parámetros. Ahí está la doctora Murphy, Margarita y Lucía Oliveira también. Tenemos ahí con nosotros. Bueno, no sé si se te activó el audio ahí, Margarita.
Señor.
Hello, everyone.
Hi. Well, Dr. Knowles, it's such an honor to share the screen with you. I absolutely loved your talk. Thank you. Thank you for all that knowledge. I really appreciated that. I wanted to ask you one specific thing. The Medtronic people are recommending using two cathodes and one anode right on the thing itself. How do you feel about that?
Well, that was the initial recommendation of Medtronic, and it's fair to say that the manufacturer's instructions have not changed recently. However, the expert opinion, both from science and from clinicians, is that the use of two cathodes confers no benefit. One of the other things that confers no benefit is having what's called a guarded cathode, which was previously also a recommendation. That's a cathode surrounded by two anodes on either side. Correct. And these were, I don't know where these recommendations came from before, but in simple terms, from the basic science of neuromodulation, it makes no sense to spread the cathodic charge, because you're reducing the focal potency of that charge in terms of separating it from the anode. It may be that having two cathodes helped with poor electrode lead placement, and that's why it was initially recommended. But with a well-placed electrode lead, there is no rationale for using two cathodes. And that is now the Medtronic view as well as ours.
And the other question that I had for you is, do you feel that if the patient has fecal incontinence as opposed to urinary incontinence, or maybe a combination of both, would you try different frequencies and those different patients?
There's no evidence for that at the moment. But there's no evidence to suggest that, other than anecdotal evidence, to suggest that the programming for urological indications differs at all from that for fecal incontinence. So there was a, to expand on this, there was a belief that fecal incontinence patients, for instance, should best feel the sensation around the anus, whereas those with urinary incontinence should feel it in the vagina or the vulva. In fact, with the data coming from Stefan de Wachter's group, indicate that this is a nonsense. The important thing, it's in the midline, and it varies patient to patient, and it doesn't appear to matter that much in terms of efficacy.
And for the sake of practical purposes, when you have a patient who says, you know, Dr. Knowles, I was doing great, I have had no accidents, I was feeling my stimulation right at in the vulva, all of a sudden I feel it in the buttock, and I'm all of a sudden having accidents. What do you recommend our people here visiting to do in this case?
Well, I would get the patient back to clinic face to face. In my case, that would be with one of my specialist nurses, who would then run through not only the impedances of the electrodes, but also try a number of programs, including returning to the basics of testing each electrode And if there genuinely is a problem with that isn't rectified back to the midline by doing that, or a problem with the impedance, I'm in favour of the early X-ray of those patients and early intervention. I think for far too long, all of us have sent patients back and forth with different sets of programs, returning to clinic 3 months later, 6 months later, 6 months later. And this was borne out by the Maeda's papers from Denmark, which showed this, you know, a proportion of the patients who had a colossal number of visits and reprogrammings, only to end up with requiring a lead revision. So my view is that if it's particularly if it's migrated off the midline,
We lost you the last few minutes.
Okay, shall I say it again? So yeah, I said, please. I think, I don't know where you heard up to, but I think the evidence from Yas Maeda's group in Denmark shows a significant proportion of patients who represent a huge proportion of the reprogramming visits. And so we have a minority of patients who keep coming back and forth, having unnecessary reprogramming, none of which ultimately works. And I think now the emphasis should be on the early reevaluation, the X-ray of the patient, and if necessary, an early lead replacement.
And what do you think when you check the impedances and almost all of them are perfect, and then there is two that are not, that give you the little interrogation sign, that is the interrogation sign of death to me. And do you try to reprogram them, excluding those different poles, or?
It's a good question.
Again, please. No.
Can you hear me?
No. Very bad. Bad internet. So
I'm going to stop my video and see if that helps. Shall I stop my video?
Okay. Try.
I'll stop my video. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. It's a difficult question to answer this, because I don't always trust the impedance measurements. I think sometimes the impedance can give misleading results. And I've never been able to get a satisfactory answer to this question from Medtronic, but I know that I'm not the only person who has experienced this. Mm-hmm. But if the patient has lost efficacy, and they were using electrodes that now have a high impedance, I would obviously move to the other electrodes. But I would be concerned about that lead.
Yes. Well, thank you, Sarah. It's been an amazing talk. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Lucía, te vemos ahí. Gracias por estar. Donde sea.
Hola. Margarita, yo estoy
thank you. I was running like crazy.
Pleasure. The pleasure is all mine.
Okay.
Maybe next time I can come to Argentina.
Yeah.
We all want to be in Argentina next time.
Okay.
Definitely.
After COVID.
Lucía, gracias. Charles. Doctor. Perfecto.
Charles, I enjoyed very much your talk. And I got impressed with the Spanish in the slides. Thank you so much. You know that many people that are watching us, they are not very well experienced with this therapy. So your talk is very important, because the programming process is also, as well as the implantation, as you very well addressed, we should make a lot of effort to do the best implantation as possible. And this for sure is very determinant of the success of the therapy, but also the programming is very important. And first, it can be a little bit boring if we look at of all these numbers and, you know, programming. But as we start to doing this and, you know, helping the patients, we understand that it's really very important that we can deal with this and not only asking the Medtronic guides to help us, but also to understand this. So I appreciated very much your talk. And I would like to ask you many questions because you are very experienced with this. And I know that you are doing a lot of projects and research in this field. And for instance, it's a little bit different from what you spoke, but I would like to hear, this is an opportunity for all of us to hear your experience and your thoughts about neuromodulation for other options such as IBS and IBD. I think it's a good opportunity because this is something that is very interesting, and I know that some projects are going on, so I would like to hear. The second question will be PNE. What do you think about that? Do you think here in Latin America, because of the cost issue, this could be something to help us? Or you think that doing the two stages procedure or asking immediately, testing the patients will be the best way for us?
Okay, let me answer those questions in turn. So the first question on other indications for SNM, IBS and IBD. So there are published data on IBS from, I think, a single center, but on more than one occasion from Lily Lumby and her group in Denmark, that show some effectiveness or efficacy of SNS for IBS. And those were randomized studies. They're not bad studies. And they would appear, taken at face value, to indicate some value of SNS in patients with IBS. That finding is in keeping with our belief that SNS modulates sensitivity in the anorectum. And in a sense, there is a belief that SNS can normalize abnormal rectal sensitivity, both from a position of hypersensitivity and hyposensitivity. Now, rectal hypersensitivity is a biomarker of IBS. From Whitehead's paper in 1993 onwards, and is very well researched in 2030 studies in terms of a biomarker for IBS. So there is some rationale for its value in IBS. My concern, and it's a concern that's not related to the content of Lily's paper, but more to the patient group, is the very high placebo responses in IBS patients and the difficulty of treating these patients really with anything. So I think it is an area where large-scale studies with a much larger patient number, a much more robust design and longer-term follow-up will be required to convince the judges that this is a high-value therapy for this difficult group of patients. But if I have a patient with incontinence and IBS, which isn't uncommon because 10% of patients with diarrhea-predominant IBS also have incontinence, particularly if they have hypersensitivity, I think those are a good group to target with this therapy. Are you still hearing me before I keep talking?
Yes.
Yes.
For inflammatory bowel disease, the current data in humans are limited to case reports and very small numbers of patients and a one or two mechanistic studies from France on permeability. However, the IBD literature is supported by very strong evidence from animal studies on the suppression of inflammation by stimulation of the parasympathetic nervous system. So this is the work on vagal stimulation from Irene Tracy and others published in Nature back in the 1990s and 2000s, through to a whole body of work, I think some of which is now coming from Medtronic, in relation to rodent studies looking at suppression of chemical-induced colitis in rodent models. And again, there is good rationale, either via the activation of the parasympathetic nervous system and its anti-nociceptive and anti-inflammatory effects, or the indirect effects of the parasympathetic nervous system via the spleen, mediated by the acetylcholine 7 receptor, that there may be some motivation, perhaps, in patients either with proctitis, you know, severe, unresponsive proctitis, that this may have value where other therapies have failed. But I think the positioning of the therapy will clearly be downstream of biologic drugs, because they're clearly going to be cheaper and easier to give. Maybe it will have a role in patients who are chronically dependent on steroids and immunomodulators, to try and reduce their steroid dependency. But we have no human data of any value to back that up at the current time. Mm-hmm. Personally, I think, if you ask my own view, I think, and I have no data to back this up, I think vagus nerve stimulation should be considered in patients with multiply recurrent Crohn's disease, who have no other effective therapy other than stem cell transplantation or multiple surgery. I think it would be worth giving it a go, because it may work.
Very nice.
So on to the question of PNE. Mm-hmm. Those of you who have seen me speak before will have heard me say, and this is strictly off the record from Medtronic, will have heard me say that I do not believe PNE. I don't think we should do it at all, or only in selected patients. That is that we should go direct to implant in well-selected patients with good intraoperative responses. Okay. And that argument is completely backed up by health economics. Mm-hmm. And it's also backed up following in the era of standardized lead placement by evidence that is, the majority of patients who have good on-table responses will progress to therapeutic benefit. It also reduces the infection rate that you get with the two-stage implant. And in restrained health systems, particularly like the one I work in the National Health System, the reduction of two operations to one operation will result in very significant reductions in waiting time and therefore in the patient experience. So I don't think we should use, I think the PNE should be used in patients where you're concerned about their ability to manage their therapy.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's a test of the patient's ability to do a diary, to manage their lead, to look after it. But I don't think the PNE tells you anything about the eventual efficacy of chronic multipolar stimulation.
Okay, thank you very much for the answers.
Doctor Knowles, quisiera hacer una consulta, quizás no tan técnica, pero aprovechando la gran experiencia que usted tiene, quisiera saber su opinión con respecto a la utilidad que se le ve a la neuromodulación sacra en pacientes con constipación, con tránsito lento. Usted, los trabajos hablan de porcentajes de efectividad no tan altos. ¿Eso se lo adjudica a que la muestra es heterogénea, a que la técnica no funciona, o a que todavía no está la programación correcta, y quizás que muchos piensan que es distinta la programación para la incontinencia que para la constipación, y quizás falta corregir algo de eso. ¿A qué le adjudica los no tan buenos resultados?
The results are not so good because it doesn't appear to work. So the original observational data published by Mike Cam and by others were flawed by design, and the subsequent three randomized controlled trials that have looked at this show absolutely, it's not that there is little effectiveness, there was no effectiveness over placebo, over sham stimulation. So let's be clear on this point. In patients with slow transit constipation in particular, this is not an effective therapy. And I do not believe that any amount of reprogramming or electrode configurations will make any difference to that outcome, because in fact, in Phil Dinning's study from Adelaide, Australia, which was one of the main randomized trials published in 2017 in the American Journal of Gastroenterology, they used a combination of S2 and S3 stimulation, and neither made a difference. So the answer to that question is this is the wrong group for the therapy. I do think, however, that there is a right group for the therapy who have a form of constipation, and that is patients who have a functional defecation disorder associated with rectal hyposensitivity. And this takes me back to the point I made earlier about the modulation of conscious urge to defecate, that our patients tell us all the time, and is borne out by numerous observational studies and two randomized studies, my own and one other, performed completely independently, that both showed an identical result. Now, I hasten to add that that is the only indication for SNS that has been shown in two independent randomized studies. So I think there's motivation for picking these patients who are unable to evacuate the rectum as a consequence of loss of defecatory urge because they have hyposensitivity in the anorectum. And that, of course, is completely what's the word I'm looking for? It fits completely with the urological literature, where SNS is used for Fowler's syndrome in the bladder, which is an almost identical phenomenon, where there is bladder hyposensitivity and poor bladder. So with dyssynergia of the urethral sphincter. So I think there's good rationale that we should use SNS in those patients. What's making you laugh?
Because
I press my horn here in the car.
Okay. I didn't hear it.
Very excited about your words. So if I had a horn, I would press it too.
O tráfico no Brasil.
No, I'm still in garage.
Ah, sí.
I am parked.
¿Alguien quiere hacer un comentario?
No, nada. Yo estoy
Qué placer, qué placer este momento con el doctor Knowles. No sé si tenemos 2 minutos más, no sé si quieren hacer un comentario, Margarita, si no tenemos preguntas del auditorio, Lucía. Hacemos una sola para el doctor y lo dejamos descansar tranquilo. Siempre preguntan cosas vinculadas a otro tipo de indicaciones de la neuromodulación, y lo que preguntan es cuál es su criterio con respecto a los pacientes con dolor pelviano crónico y neuromodulación.
That depends what chronic pelvic floor problem we're talking about. If we're talking about chronic pelvic pain, which I suspect the question may be about, there are some limited data, but what I would say is that the data coming from Antwerp, from Stefan de Wachter's group, support the use of pudendal nerve stimulation more than sacral stimulation in that group of patients.
Okay. Muy bien.
Perfecto. Bueno,
Bueno, doctor Knowles, es un placer haberlo tenido aquí, pese a que está de vacaciones. No sabe cuánto le agradecemos. Es para nosotros un enorme placer. Y también queremos escucharlo en la guitarra, por favor. Eso también queremos. Es tan importante o más que la neuromodulación. Muchas gracias por su presencia.
Bye, everyone.
Gracias, Margarita. Gracias, Lu.
Nos vemos a las 6 de la tarde con el doctor Anders Degring. Gracias.